Hi, I'm Andrea Stephany, CEO and co-founder of OncoSwab, and these are five things I wish someone told me before I started. Number one is beware of confirmational bias. When I first started, I started going to congresses, to events, to meet people in the industry, and also fellow startup founders to learn from them, right? And every time someone asked me about my startup, and I told them about our mission to make lung cancer screening more accessible, praise would start pouring in. What a great idea. Wow, such an important mission. If it works, it'll be a success. I felt totally validated. And I thought, everybody thinks it's a great idea. It's totally gonna be a success. It wasn't until one of my mentors called me out and told me, you are under confirmational bias. Going to congresses and saying, I want to disrupt lung cancer diagnostics is like telling your mom, oh, I'm gonna conquer the world. Everybody will say it's great. But that really means very little. These people have no skin in the game. They're not investing. They're not buying the product. They're not signing letters of intent. So it's by no means a real confirmation of a real market need. There are two books that help me understand this better. The Right It by Alberto Savoia and Talking to Humans by Giff Constable. Highly recommend it. Number two, it's an interview, not a conversation. At the beginning of your startup journey, when you're interviewing potential customers or end users to understand the problem better, it's very easy to get a little too excited because at the end of the day, you're both connected to the same problem. So when you get too excited, an interview can turn into a conversation about a particular topic very easily. For example, when I started interviewing doctors about lung cancer screening, I would often give my opinion after the person answered. And I'd say things like, oh yeah, and under 6% of people don't undergo lung cancer screening, that's terrible, blah, blah, blah. That not only came across as know-it-all, because if you know so much, then why are you bothering me with questions? But it can make you miss the entire point of the interview, which is to truly understand your user's problem. So focus on listening and understanding their point of view instead of giving your opinion. Number three, everybody has advice to give. Take it all with a grain of salt. When I had my very first meetings with professionals in the industry, my imposter syndrome was at its highest. And I thought that every single human being, because they had been in the industry for longer than I have, they knew more than I did and they had to be right and everything they said was pure gold. Every person's advice will be based on their own specific journey and everybody's journey is different and your journey is for sure completely different than theirs. If you were to listen to everybody's advice, you would go crazy. So hear them out, collect advice from people who have made it, people that you admire, but it's ultimately your job to decide what's best for your company, and you're gonna have to trust your skills and your gut to make the right decision. Number four, be proactive and follow up. When you're starting off, you're gonna meet a lot of accomplished people. Even though a lot of them will be well ahead of you, you'll notice how almost everybody really wants to help. The thing is, it's easy to get caught up in the moment of an in-person interaction or a Zoom call or whatnot and promise things, promise introductions or promise help, and then not deliver. Don't take this personally. The chances are that that person also has another billion things to do. Be proactive, follow up. What I do is I send an email and I say, hey, thank you so much for our conversation today. I love talking about XYZ. Thank you for offering a connection to your friend, blah, blah. To make things easier for you, here's a blurb of what my company does. Right, like 2-3 lines of what your company does. That way you're making it easy for the person to just copy paste and easily forward it. You're the one that needs help. So it's up to you to do the heavy lifting and make it easy for people to help you. Lastly, focus on making long-term connections. This is something that took me a while to understand and I wish I would have learned my lesson sooner. If I was at a conference, for example, and I was talking to somebody that had the potential to be a really good connection, I used to think, okay, I have them in front of me. If they're going to help me, it's gotta be now. Otherwise, I'll never see them again and they'll forget about me. But the truth is, a person will rarely be truly helpful to you after just meeting you for a few minutes. People will help, as in really help, if they genuinely care about you. And that can take some time. So instead of desperately trying to get an introduction out of someone or a connection out of someone, I learned that sometimes the best way to make long-lasting connections are genuine conversations with no clear end in mind, just out of the pure pleasure of connecting. It's better to plant a seed for the future and take the time to foster the connections you really care about than to expect quick returns on loose, sporadic connections. I hope you like this video and stay tuned for more.